Okay, so we've been talking about the Christian lifestyle, and it is important to note that anything that mentions the Christian lifestyle and doesn't mention the Holy Spirit is a complete waste of time. Because all these things are completely void without the work of the Holy Spirit. It is impossible to witness, to stay on your A game, to be able to focus in on God, to be able to have progress through prayer, to be able to really walk in the power of God without the Holy Spirit. You know, I'm in the middle of teaching about cults and apologetics and witnessing in my young adults class, and one of the things that I keep alluding to is the fact that ultimately, when you're witnessing to people in the cults, they're not going to listen to what you're saying. And so it's not necessarily about the knowledge and the wisdom aspect of what you have to say. I'm sorry, but the knowledge and the words of what you have to say. But the wisdom in your timing, the wisdom in your prayer, prayer is key, and then also the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. That is something that is unbeatable. Because long past the emotions of the cult, the Holy Spirit is there in power. Long past the emotions of the cult leaving. Remember that people fall into cults because of the emotion that goes with it. Okay? It feels right. But the power of the Holy Spirit is something that cannot be duplicated. It is something that is temporarily given by demons and cults. You know, demons will temporarily make the person feel better. They will make the person feel welcome, answer all their hardest questions, obviously they'll answer them wrong, but still give them an answer. So the empowerment of the Holy Spirit is key. And also, you know, prayer is too. I do wanna say that. Prayer really is important. I know sometimes prayer gets downgraded because some people go to the extreme of faith prayers and they just get way off topic on that. And so then other people fall in suit by going to the other extreme and saying, you know what? I just don't see the benefit of prayer. So, how are we made into a new creation? By the work of the Holy Spirit. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. John 14. You know, and the truth is known for those who are looking. It's obvious for them. But for those people who aren't looking, they won't find. Okay, like for instance, cultists and stuff, like the Jehovah's Witness and the Mormons, they're always misquoting these verses, and then even if you can conjure up a cultist to start reanalyzing stuff, they'll only reanalyze stuff by going to their cult leaders or by going to their cult materials to answer it. They won't do research on it. They won't discover historical stances on stuff. They won't find out if there's any actual proof for their claims. They won't find out any of these things. They'll just blindly quote it because someone else told them. So, I mean, it's extremely difficult to get past that. Because emotionally they are tied to this cult. Emotionally they are tied to the leader of this cult. So, John 14, verse 16, says, And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever. And then 26, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you. Now, obviously, he's one of the big things that he's talking about is the way that the Holy Spirit reminded the apostles and them who walked with Jesus. But it is also important to note that the Holy Spirit will also bring to mind those things for the person who's witnessing too. And he will give you the words to say. And that's why I said that the Holy Spirit will only bring to mind what is already there. If you don't read the Bible, you can't possibly expect the outcome and the consequences of having read your Bible. The Holy Spirit can't remind you of verses that you never read. He can't remind you of verses that you didn't memorize. He can't remind you of communion with God, with the Father that you never had. He can't do these things because you never had them to do in the first place. So, the Holy Spirit wants to make you a reflection of God's character. This doesn't mean we're going to be robots. We're also going to have our own personal, you know, character that makes us. We just won't be sinful. Okay, And we'll have the motives of God, we'll have the heart of God, that kind of an idea. But once again, we are not being conformed into God. We are not going to be little gods. That would be a drastic misassociation of what he's trying to say. Romans 8:29 said, "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." Upon salvation, the Holy Spirit begins a work in you. Okay? Upon salvation, everybody has a measure of the Holy Spirit who is saved. Obviously, there has to be an actual thing that happened. You can't simply go through the motions. This has to be an actual relationship with the Father. Galatians 5:16 says, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." And verses 22 through 26, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other." Okay. And then, gifts of the Spirit are given by the Spirit as he wills. 1 Corinthians 12, 14, or I'm sorry, 4 through 11. Says, "There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in every one, it is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, to another a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit." And notice that in between the things he's talking about with the gifts of the Spirit, chapter 13, he talks about love. Even if you have all these gifts of the Spirit and you're being used in mighty ways of the Lord, but you don't have love, it's completely pointless. The people aren't going to listen to you. You're not going to understand it yourself. You're just going to say these words, and you're going to say it in a really bad way. "The Lord's going to bring judgment and destruction on you." You know, yes, when we live in sin, God does bring things by to pull us out of the sin. He desperately desires that we do not send ourselves to destruction, obviously. But with that being said, that doesn't mean that he wants you to say it like that. What did Jeremiah say? "I have not desired destruction. I have not desired it." To another, miraculous powers, to another, prophecy, to another, distinguishing between spirits, to another, speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Okay? So, and then 14:1. "Follow the way of love and eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy." 2 Timothy 1:6. "For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands." Now, why I read that is because I want to talk about this. Sometimes when we're using the gifts of the Spirit, we kind of back off, okay? And I'm not saying that that's necessarily what's happening in the book of Timothy. I'm just saying I'm drawing a new application. When God uses you, keep seeking and keep allowing him to use you. If he hasn't used you yet, keep seeking and allow him to use you. It's something that you don't just arrive one day. You keep seeking after the Lord, and he uses you as he wills. Being filled with or baptized by the Spirit is when the Holy Spirit anoints you. Okay? Because the Holy Spirit, remember, everybody who's saved has a measure of the Holy Spirit. It's just having more of him active in your life. Having him closer, having more of his influence in your life. Okay, it's not like being demon possessed. Okay, he doesn't like take control of you and you're just not in control and you see things through something else. It's not like that. Okay, you're still there. Okay, it's just it's hard to explain. And you know the thing is, you can't give the experience. You can't give the experience to someone so that they'll be comfortable with experiencing it. The experience is the experience itself. There's no practice test. There's no dry run. But it's not what you would imagine. And just remember that where the Holy Spirit is, there's definitely peace. There's definitely understanding. There's that calmness, okay? The Holy Spirit doesn't just frighten people. There. Speaking in tongues is the evidence of being filled. Okay? So, if this is different than the gift of tongues, okay, it is possible to speak in tongues once and then just, like, kind of not so much. I spoke in tongues when I was first filled, and then I was used in gifts of the Spirit, but not so much, where you would speak something in another language, okay? And then there's the words of knowledge, those, and the interpretations, those. But tongues are not always spoken in a knowable language. Sometimes they are, but sometimes they're not. And this is one of the areas that Mormons are wrong in. Just because when you're filled with the Holy Spirit and you speak in tongues doesn't mean that you're going to do that on a regular basis. But we are supposed to be filled with the Spirit on a regular process, okay? And the way Acts is written, it's not written to simply record facts, but it's not written to necessarily condone everything. But it's written in such a way where we are able to distinguish those things that the church is supposed to do. And the activity of the Holy Spirit is something that we are supposed to do. So, and not simply because God never told us to stop being filled with the Holy Spirit, but because of what the scriptures say themselves. And I encourage you to do some study on this. Okay, so upon salvation, everyone has a measure of the Spirit. I mentioned that. You can thereby be used by the Spirit, okay? Being filled is simply getting more of God in your life. The Holy Spirit does not possess us. It works and flows through us. With that being said, that sometimes people kind of word things a little bit weird, being touched by the Lord and these different things, and talking about an emotional touch. I mean, it's not, nowadays, especially in today's sex crazed culture, you know, people are getting molested and those kinds of things, and then we talk about God the Father, and we talk about God touching us and different things. And for those who don't know, it does sound perverted. And so I would encourage maybe using different vocabulary when you are describing these things to new converts. I would definitely encourage that. We need to be sensitive to the fact that people do come from mixed backgrounds, and we can't simply expect them to know because they're in a church. You know, some of these people aren't coming back to the Lord. They've never been with the Lord. They're pre-Christian, not post-Christian. So, it's not like there's two different kinds of Christians. There's a saved and then there's a super saved. No, there's you're either saved or you are not saved. That is it. And for those who are saved, they have a measure of the Holy Spirit. It's just to what extent the Holy Spirit is a part of your life. Okay, so he does not take control and send you into a trance. When he moves, he does not go against Scripture. The Holy Spirit will never do things against Scripture. Okay, so if a word is given that contradicts the Bible, it is wrong. Even if an angel itself gives this, it is wrong. He will never ask you to do something that is not godly or biblical. You are filled with the Spirit simply by persistently seeking God and asking Him, and it's that simple. For those who don't believe in this kind of stuff, I would encourage you to go on a missions trip to India and stay there for a few months and be involved with the different demon possessed people and those kinds of things and see how real it actually is. People are still demon-possessed today. The Holy Spirit does still move today. I mean, Jesus, go to Africa for a few months and you'll see this. The Holy Spirit definitely still moves today. You are filled with the Spirit. Okay, I already mentioned that. You are used in the gifts as you earnestly desire and fan it to flame. Okay? And honestly, don't seek so much the blessings. Seek the Lord and the blessings come. See, you don't seek the blessings. Sometimes we do that when we're seeking after the Holy Spirit. So, evidence of the work of the Holy Spirit is, first off, overflowing fullness of the already present Spirit. This is something where you feel it, okay? Yes, this is very subjective. John, But I will say this. When demons possess someone, when demons are involved in someone's life, whatever your view on possession, okay? When demons are involved in someone's life, at first they will feel good. It'll help them, you know, to feel empowered and whatnot. But eventually, okay, they will fall, and the consequences of that will be negative. And they'll still want the power that they experienced, but without the consequences. Okay, and then eventually they reach a place of being bound in the consequences where there's no longer any power. See, demons will sometimes make people feel good for a limited time, and people just assume that's you know a sign of approval because it felt good. But remember, when the Holy Spirit moves, there's evidence of that, and it also doesn't have a bad consequence. Okay, it's not like you'll wake up one day and say, "Oh, I just feel so depleted." No, that's not the work of the Holy Spirit. John 7. 37-39, really a lot of confusion about the spiritual realm, a lot of confusion about the spiritual realm. Christians cannot be demon-possessed because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and where the Holy Spirit is, the demons cannot be. John 7, but they can have as much influence in your life as you let them. Let me say that. If you watch a lot of horror movies, expect to have problems. Expect it. It's just a matter of time. I was witnessing this one family. Their daughter was having some problems, seeing things that weren't there and those kinds of things. And they were watching horror movies all the time. I told them to get rid of the horror movies. They did, and voila, problem solved. The little girl started sleeping well at night. So, I mean, it's things where if you let them have control, they will have control. And some people. Devoted Christians claim instances where a demon was able to gain control over them, like while they're speaking or those kinds of things. I honestly don't know how to feel about that because I've never experienced that. But I do know that by right, they shouldn't have any control over your body. There's no reason why that should happen, except for if you are not living the righteous life. But with that being said, I would encourage if that is something that happens, once again, I never experienced that, and I've never known somebody in person who has experienced that, just, you know, heard about it and seen other people. I would encourage prayer and fasting, and if you come from a bad background, give it time. You have to keep seeking the Lord, and there is a process. And God is not Burger King. It's not have it your way as soon as you order. John 7, 37-39. But if you'd like some Burger King, they're amazing. The only thing I don't like about Burger King is they have these really good, they're like chicken nugget fry things. Oh my goodness. But then they only bring them around every so often. I hate that. Oh, hate that. John 7, 37-39. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." By this he meant the Spirit whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. So, also the empowerment of service is another evidence of the Holy Spirit moving. Consecration, and then what I mean by the empowerment for service, you feel strengthened to do a task, maybe you feel emboldened to witness, that kind of stuff. Consecration to God and dedication to his kingdom and work. So basically feeling more devoted to God. A deepened awe of God, maybe. And the thing is be careful of people who say that, you know, the Spirit moved or whatever. First off, I heard one person say that he felt the Holy Spirit come on him during an AC/DC song. Well, let me just clear up the confusion. No, you didn't. That's called emotion. That's a feeling. That's called getting the tingles from music that you feel empowers you or whatever. That has nothing to do with the Holy Spirit, okay? Occasionally, the Holy Spirit can move through a service, but it's not the evidence of the Holy Spirit moving, okay? So, this is the evidence of the Holy Spirit moving. Do you have a deepened awe of God? Do you want to know him better? Do you want to spread his kingdom? Are these things that you feel? Consider the apostles. 40 days after Jesus had arisen, they're in Jerusalem proclaiming. Well, what happened in simply 40 days? What happened in 3 days between Jesus' death and his resurrection? they saw Jesus. They saw him resurrected. Remember, they were distraught. Their leader was just cursed by being hung on the tree, right? Remember? And taken off the same day so that the curse didn't come on the land. You know, with that being said, you know, what changed? They were all distraught. Let's go fishing, I guess. And then 3 days later, they're all, woohoo! See what I mean? And then 40 days after he ascended, you know, they're in Jerusalem proclaiming the same place that he was crucified at, and they're able to proclaim with power and in different languages for the people, and you know, just a wonderful work there. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Chapter 2, 42-43. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Let me stop there. An act of love for Christ, his work, and the lost. Mark 16:20. Be really careful of people who say that they felt the Holy Spirit or something, or were using the gifts of the Holy Spirit or something, or whatever, and then go out and live just however the heck they want. Then the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it. The Holy Spirit is the only way to meet your full potential in life and ministry. A church trying to fulfill its ministry without the Holy Spirit is like trying to plow a field with a pebble. It's extremely difficult, very unsuccessful. It's doing things in your own power, if you will. It's just very, very bad. And I've been to some dead churches, and let me tell you. There's just no unity, there's no peace. The Holy Spirit brings things that you're not able to accomplish elsewhere. And I will say this, worshiping in a congregation brings some things that you will not be. It brings knowledge and brings depth in your spiritual walk that you will not be able to receive by other means. Even devotions in your own household. Okay, there's just something that is gained through joining together as a family. To worship the Lord, that is not able to be replicated. The Holy Spirit will not regularly move when there is no unity. If you want the Holy Spirit to move, you have to obey by not allowing the devil to have a foothold. Even after you are filled, continually seek, and God wants to bring you closer to Himself. But I've kind of already mentioned these things. Really, ultimately, what it comes down to is you just have to seek the Lord. But God does guide our paths. Proverbs 3, 5 through 6 says, and not to lean on your own understanding. Proverbs 4, 18 through 19. The path of the righteous is like the morning sun, shining ever brighter till the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble. They don't know what makes them stumble. And then Proverbs 16:9. We're reaching the end of this lesson here. In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. So God definitely does guide our paths. I'm not saying that every second of every day is predestined, and I'll let you come to your own conclusions on that. But, we need to analyze things like, you know, luck and those kinds of things and see if that is actually a factor or not. And be aware that God definitely does guide our paths. And guides the direction of our life and those kinds of things. Seek God's kingdom and His way and you will have nothing to fear. I'm sorry, if we go our own way, we go to disaster. I kind of mentioned that before, but... The results of our own way is definitely destruction. Seek God's kingdom and His way, you will have nothing to fear. He changes us and our desires as we seek after Him. Sin causes us to want things that are not of God. But when we have fellowship with the Lord, it changes our desires, it changes our focus in life. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. So, submission to God and his ways are the basis of true success and happiness. Submission to God and his way of doing life. You know, people think, oh, if I get to be a Christian, I'm going to have fun, that, you know, I won't be happy and all kinds of different things. But the truth is, when you're a Christian, you don't desire to do these things anymore. You don't desire to live like the world does. And you truly do become happy. You know, with that being said, those, you know, of you who may justify not being saved because of losing out on a happiness, are you really that happy now? You know, you wake up with a headache, you know, you have no purpose, really. You have no reason for belief. You have no reason for morality. You have no reason for any of this stuff. So evil deeds produce evil deeds. Porn leads to anger and more lusts. If you look at porn, you will eventually partake of other lusts. You will overeat, or you will oversleep, or you will maybe abuse your child, or those kinds of things, yell at your wife, these kinds of things, because lust leads to lust. You don't become more content by window shopping. That's just not a thing. As well as shattered relationships. Porn also causes shattered relationships. If you are underage, expect to have bad relationship with your parents. If you are married, expect to have bad relationships with your mom and with your wife. Pot leads to laziness. Alcohol leads to anger. These are things that can't be separated. When you partake of something, evil will always produce more evil. That's just what happens. Oh, I'll just do this one thing and it'll be okay because I'll just do this one thing. No, because once again, if it's an evil thing that you're doing, that evil thing will always breed more evil things. Sometimes we want to change, but need to change what we allow in our lives. Why is it doing this? There we go. In order to change, okay? Does that make sense? So in other words, sometimes we'll want to change, we'll want things to be different, okay? But we allow some things in our lives, and that's what's not allowing, that's what's making it where we can't change. Okay. I want to be a calmer person. I want to be more patient. Well, are you looking at porn? Are you drinking? Are you doing these things that you know you shouldn't be doing? See what I mean? What are you allowing in your lives that is making it where you cannot change? So one sin leads to more sin. That's just what happens. I mean, there's no way of fighting it. And so if you want to serve God with a humble heart, if you want that result, you have to sacrifice of yourself. I don't think I can be a Christian because I don't think I can love. I don't think that I can. I don't want to be this prideful person. I want to serve God, but I just don't think that I can. Sacrifice of yourself. The Christian lifestyle is not about living how you want to live or how others want you to live, but how God wants you to live. And we saw how God would have lived through Jesus, didn't we? Went through his word, too. Allow yourself to be inconvenienced. I will say that. Sacrifice of yourself. Allow yourself to be inconvenienced. I don't have time for that. Make time for it. Make time for it. When you start seeing other people's needs, it definitely does change your heart. If you really want to sacrifice of yourself, and if you're having a hard time with that, like for instance, if you're not saved or whatever, simply just seek after the Lord, and he does a work in you. But I feel like if I go any longer on this lesson, I'm just going to cause more confusion. So I'm going to go ahead and stop there. If you have any questions, post them below. Next lesson, lesson 10, is about reinvention, the idea of not plateauing. So.